In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Jesus said, "Beware of the scribes. They love to dress well, be greeted with respect in public, get the best seats, synagogues, and banquets. They take advantage of widows' hospitality. Those are the people that can least afford to share such things. And they like to run on and on at the mouth." Well, just who are these scribes, the ones who have Jesus' obvious irritation? Well, the scribes could be described as something like a religious lawyer. In the world of Jesus, there are two kinds of law. There's the Jewish law, which you've heard me talk about before. The Jewish law with a capital L. This is derived from the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. Then there is the Roman law. That's the law of the empire. You see the way that the Roman Empire worked. Rome was content to let local people follow local custom and to follow local law, unless, of course, it disrupted the smooth efficiency of the Roman Empire. If that would happen, then the law of Rome would come down quick, heavy, and often violent to quash any type of rebellion. So in the world of Jesus, the Jewish law governed the Jewish people for the most part. And again, that law comes from the first five books of the Bible, which is attributed to Moses, the great leader of the children of Abraham. In those writings, of course, are the Ten Commandments. But it had morphed into some 613 identifiable commandments. So the scribes then, they were the lawyers, the ones who interpret those laws. And as you might imagine, they were well educated. And so the scribes were, they were very knowledgeable, the ever-growing intricacies of the law. And then they, of course, would offer their own commentary, which in turn was taken as law itself. So then, scribes were admired in some circles. They were deferred to. Their opinion was sought after, and many of those, people, not all of them, but many of those were quite ambitious. And as Jesus points out, some of them took full selfish advantage of their position. Jesus, as you saw in the gospel, sees them something as pompous and condescending. Here's the thing I think that really raised Jesus' ire towards these institutional leaders is that they called attention to the institution rather than to God. And they call attention to their prominence rather to the mission and service of the people of God. Well, following several confrontations with those in the temple, with scribes, with others, Jesus said, I think it's likely so you can collect his thoughts to take in the grand surroundings of the temple. So Jesus is there watching people putting money into the treasury. Now think of the treasury as a rather large collection box. And there were actually 13 of those within the temple. And on top of every one of those, there's something called a trumpet. And that's because that's what it looked like. It looked like a horn that was wider at the top and narrower at the bottom. The currency of that day was all coins. And so these coins make a lot of noise when they're dropped into the trumpets. Lots of coins, lots of noise, and lots of attention. Now rich and generous people contributed lots and lots of coins that make lots and lots of noise. That's not a bad thing. But in contrast to the scribes and the wealthy, Jesus points out someone that he calls a poor widow. And she contributes all that she has, everything. Two small coins, very little noise, and no attention at all. The others, Jesus says, they give out of their abundance, which is generous. Do not give them. To give out of your abundance is generous. But this unnamed woman, we never know her name, her giving is sacrificial. She gives her all. one other such woman. This woman's name was Osceola McCarty. She is a very amazing person. Out of her poverty, but yet out of her generosity, she gave everything that she had. She died a number of years ago at the age of 91. She's an African-American woman from Hattiesburg, Mississippi. And for the bulk of her life, she made her living by washing and ironing other people's clothes. She left school in the sixth grade so that she could take over her mother's laundry. She never married. She never had a car. It was in her 80s, in the stifling summer weather in the South, she bought her first air conditioner. It was a small living room. Arthritis forced her to retire finally at the age of 86. She scrimped and saved, was frugal all her life. And then she made a gift to the University of Southern Mississippi of $150,000. And so that fund was able to set up scholarships for African Americans of limited means. Since then, hundreds and hundreds of other contributions to that fund have raised thousands and thousands of dollars. Hearing this story, Ted Turner, he gave away $1 billion. But even $1 million to Ted Turner is only a small part of his surplus. Osceola McCarty gave everything. Some of us give to God out of our abundance, which is truly a blessing to be able to do that. It's a blessing and a joy. Some, like that unnamed woman, and a woman whose name we know as Osceola McCarty, they gave their all, which is a great blessing and a joy for those to do so. Think about it. None of us here are truly poor. Not a single one of us. None of us here are truly poor. But yet, I don't think anybody here would say that we're rich by any means. How then should we, kind of there in that big middle, how should we give of our resources to God? Well, there are three identifiable ways that I see in the Bible. In the Old Testament, there is something that's called the tithe. That's 10% of whatever one has, money, produce, 10% is given to God in the temple. Now, some of the first and early Christians, they held all things in common. Essentially, they lived in a commune. You can read about that in Acts of the Apostles. They gave everything. They gave absolutely everything to the community. But what's Jesus say? What does Jesus say about all this? You realize that after God, Jesus talks more about money and wealth and our relationship to money and wealth than anything else. Talks more about that. But Jesus never tells us how much to give, ever, ever. Jesus never even mentions the tithe that we have a record of. Jesus says, only be generous. Be generous in everything that we do. Some of you know that I'm privileged to celebrate, to preach at the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C. about once a month. Most of you have seen it. It's a stunningly beautiful structure that's dedicated to the worship and the service of God. And as you might expect also, on the days I'm there, that I get the tourists are going through all the time, and I get to interact with a lot of people. My experience there is that the people are surprised when they come to the National Cathedral. They're surprised about two things. First of all, it's not Roman Catholic. Some people make the assumption that it just ought to be a Roman Catholic. Well, it's not. It's Anglican. It's Episcopalian. It's one of ours. The second thing that they're surprised about is that it's not a national institution in the formal sense of the word. It's not a federal edifice. Well, and I tell people at the offertory, when I celebrate Mass there at the offertory, that the National Cathedral only continues its mission through the generosity of those who love it. Same thing. Same thing here at St. Peter's. This is a stunningly beautiful building. I just love it. And we have a heartfelt mission and witness and service. Our big challenge ahead of us is Now that we've come past conflict, now that we've come past the terrible, what will be our presence in this community? You do need to know that St. Peter's has no endowment, we have no reserve, and we often do struggle financially, as we're doing a little bit right now. So I can say the same thing, equally true, and that St. Peter's will continue its mission only through the generosity of those who love it. I want help, she said. I want help. I want to help someone's child go to college, said Osceola McCarty. I just want my contribution to go to someone who will appreciate it and to someone who will learn. I can't do everything, she said, but I can do something to help somebody. I wish I could do more, but I will do what I will do. Jesus doesn't tell us how much to give, ever, but Jesus does invite us to be generous. Be generous in the name of God in every way that you can be, as God has already been excessively generous and loving and inclusive to you. Be generous in all that you do, in your attitudes, in your relationships, and in your offerings. And just as important as that, just as important, be grateful. Be grateful. Be so very grateful to God for the many blessings that God has already given to you and to us and to this community. In God's name.
Amen.